Stone Age, Egyptians, Romans, Greeks. In the medieval time, we had Byzantine, Romanesque and Gothic, then Renaissance. They all had created architectural elements such as arches, aqueducts, bridges, military boats, arts, and many more precious venues such as a philosophy and mathematics, including the science and writing. But with one main interest they all had was architecture. Historical civilizations are often identified with their surviving architectural achievements. We build what we value. Having said that, let's explore the Stone Age period and voyage through a timeline that will bring us to a world where the activities, spirits, or time of the great revival of art, literature, and learning in Europe, where it took place in the 14th century and extend into the 17th century, marking the transition from the medieval to the modern world.
Dolmen of Menga. It is one of the largest known ancient megalithic structures. The stone structure was covered with soil and built up into the hill. Beehive made of bones. In 1965, in Mezirik in Ukraine, a farmer dug up the lower jawbone of the mammoth while in the process of expanding his cellar. Further excavations revealed the presence of four huts made up of a total of 149 mammoth bones. These dwellings, dating back some 15,000 years, were determined to have been some of the oldest shelters known to have been constructed by prehistoric men, usually attributed to Cro-Magnon. Paul Lebrun dolmen consists of a 12-foot thin, slab-like, tubular capstone supported by two sets of slender upright parallel portal stones, which support the capstone 1.8 meters high from the ground, creating a chamber in a 9-meter low cairn. The cairn helped stabilize the tomb chamber and would have been no higher during the Neolithic. The entrance faces north and is crossed by a low steel stone. Moving forward to a different level of architecture and in place of the world where they were called pharaoh and belonging to dynasties, the Egyptians. The Orion correlation theory is an assumption of the Egyptology. It says that there is a correlation between the location of the three largest pyramids of the Giza complex and Orion's belt of the constellation Orion. The stars of Orion were associated with Osiris, the god of rebirth and afterlife, by the ancient Egyptians, and the Nile River can be included to match with the Milky Way galaxy. The Giza's pyramids are a copy carbon of the stars forming the belt in the constellation of Orion. The three pyramids exactly simulate the star Delta Orionis, Mintaka, the small star, Epsilon, and Zeta. The Great Sphinx and the pyramids are part of the most recognizable symbols of the civilizations of ancient Egypt and of the Giza Plateau in Cairo. Continental drift and plate tectonics have changed the angle of the north position of minus 3.4 arc minutes azimuth off to the true north, as it is measured from a sphere to the true north. There is a movement of about 100 meters for the Giza Plateau at the Mokadam mountain formations and possibly some significant rotation. Giza is moving fast because of the contact point of the African, Arabian, and Eurasian tectonic plates. Another issue is the possible impact of the sea of the Giza Plateau. The level of the Mediterranean Sea has raised about 2 meters during the last 5,000 years, which has perhaps affected the tilt of the plateau. One of the last rulers of the 18th dynasty, Tutankhamun, King Tut. Inside of the tomb, his sarcophagus known for the treasure found inside. His stepmother was a queen Nefertiti. His mother was a noble woman called Kea. His father was Akhenaten, known as Amenhotep. His wife was also his half-sister, Ankhensinamen. Incest was recognized in Egypt to preserve the royal bloodline. King Tut ruled from 1333 BC until about 1323 BC. Historians put his age at death at age of 19 years old. Cholera disease, a rare born disorder, died of malaria. The most famous tomb is KV62, the tomb of King Tutankhamun. The discovery of King Tut's tomb was made by Howard Carter on November 4, 1922, with clearance and conservation work continuing until 1932. Tutankhamun's tomb was the first royal tomb to be discovered that was still largely intact. King Tutankhamun was a rather minor king. In other burials, probably had more numerous treasures. Although the tomb was relatively small and undecorated compared to the other tomb in the Valley of the King, it had a wall reflecting the first stage of the afterlife of Tut. Some of the chamber were walled off for the previous owner, Queen Nefertiti, who may lie there. It is said that his older sister, Meritaten, his possibly mother, Kenya, could also be in a tomb in secret chambers. However, the Egyptians' empire world vanished. The following of the map of the world were the Greeks. In looking into their world, the Parthenon is forming the pillar of what is to become an empire civilization. The Parthenon, a splendor, a magnificent building as viewed today. The columns are Doric order and they are identified with the simplest clean non-existing base to the columns. At the upper part of the columns, a simple circular capital with a square on top to support the frieze. The shaft is curved, fluted, emphasis versus straight line, which it gives a sense of height and elegance. The frieze has triglyphs representing the end of the beams. It has 92 metopes. In the city of Athens, an aristocrat named Pericles changed the world, changed the vision on ruling the government and engineering the Parthenon, the perfect building proportion, and built on the Acropolis of Athens, the sacred rock, the high city. This area was dedicated to Athena, goddess of reason, intelligence, activities, arts, and literature. Greek world has seen today through history was an important time where the modern world is based on. We have heard many times about the Greek mythology gods. Here are some names: Athena, Hephaestus, Dionysus, Apollo, Poseidon, Zeus, Hermes, Hades, Hestia, Hera, Eris, and Aphrodite. So, in the world of the mortals, many buildings look alike with some variations. Let's look at two of them. Both temples had Athena involved. The Parthenon is where the status of Athena was placed, and as for a Hephaestus temple, a classic example of the Dorian architecture, it was dedicated to Hephaestus and Athena. This civilization, run by emperors, became the center of the world as they exploded toward the most powerful and structured civilization, an empire. Archaic period, the birthplace of the Western civilization. By 1300 BC, Mycenaean civilizations, last phase of Bronze Age in ancient Greece, they were representing the first advanced civilizations and laid foundations of Greek civilization through war and scandals. Agamemnon siege of Troy with Trojan horse. Then, fall of the Mycenaeans and the Greek entered into a dark age for four centuries. Polycrates ruled Amos in 540 BC, a tyrant. Themistocles led the war against the Persians. Once Athens became an empire, Spartan felt threatened. The Spartanians moved on Athens for 2 years' siege. Disease killed many people, the Great Athenian Plague. The war between Spartans and Athenians was the Peloponnesian War and lasted 25 years. Athens fell. Two men, Philip II, a Macedonian, the purveyors, and Pericles' son, Alexander the Great. Greek idea was spread, moral, culture, up to today. Olympic was invented by the Greeks to recruit soldiers. Alexander the Great, the most forceful world conqueror, also known as Alexander III of Macedon. He was a king of the ancient Greek kingdom of Macedonia. and a member of the Agian dynasty. Alexander was appointed to the throne at the age of 20. He spent most of his king time, years, with a never-seen-before military campaign through Asia and Northeast Africa. By the age of 30, he had created one of the largest empires of the ancient world. It was stretching from Greece to Egypt and into Northwest India. He was successful in all battles, and he is considered one of history's most successful military commanders. Alexander conquered Persian Empire, Anatolia, Syria, Phoenicia, Judea, Egypt, Bactria, and Mesopotamia, and as far as the Punjab. He was also planned to conquer Europe. He then took his father's dream to lead the Greek army into the conquest of Persia. He invaded the Achaemenid Empire, ruled Asia Minor. Seeking to reach the end of the world at the Great Outer Sea, he invaded India in 326 BC, but was eventually forced to turn back at the demand of his troops. Alexander died in Babylon in 323 BC. They invented crossbow, gastafates, and torsion catapult boat shooter. Built a causeway between mainland of Lebanon and Tyre, then a siege tower, then went to Egypt. He was crowned then a pharaoh, made him a god, son of Amen. Hellenistic period, Stoa, theater invented by Greek, important aspect of Greek outlook to the world, inspired the Roman with the Colosseum in Rome. How was the life within the Greek world of this empire? They had Stoa, with a courtyard, halls of columns with small rooms. Greek invented democracy and Olympics. They invented amphitheater, storytelling place, stadium, temples, columns, city development, Stoa, agora, way of living, democracy, structure engineered, and war strategy. Once the Greek empire collapsed, another civilization took over, the Romans. In July 13th, 100 BC, known as Julius Caesar, a Roman politician, general, and notable author of Latin prose, took Rome to a different level. How that civilization became to rule a large conquered land and create this powerful empire? Ambition, conquest, lust, murder, power of unrivaled technology, all cornerstones of the foundation of the Roman Empire, driven by cultural ego. Stadium, palace, road, aqueduct were symbol of idea of Rome, but they were powerless to prevent their own destruction. It was in 753 BC that Rome was founded by Romulus and Remus, two brothers. Rome was named after Romulus. Cloacae Maxima, a sewer system, was the first massive engineering achievement of the city and still active today, 2,500 years later. There, they built the Forum. Then they built roads across the land by 312 BC with the Appian Way, first paved road built by Appius Claudius. Successor of Caesar was Augustus, crowned first emperor. They had waterproof concrete, a mix for volcanic sand, water, and lime. In 41 AD, most of the royal family were murdered to avenge the bloody reign of Claudius' nephew, Caligula. But Claudius was hiding cowardly behind curtains and was not killed, and became an emperor. He conquered Britannia and built two major aqueducts, the Aqua Claudius and Annio Novus. Claudius' downfall was his lifestyle, women and wives, luxurious, subservient to them. He married his own niece, Agrippina, sister of Caligula, and was seeking her own power, and made sure her son, Nero, from a previous marriage, would be his heir and would accede to the throne instead of his biological son. 4 years later, he was killed, poisoned by a mushroom. Nero then became the emperor, an engineered disaster by being viewed corrupt and compulsive. He burned three-quarters of Rome in 64 AD to build his own palatial complex. Nero blamed the fire for a new religion called the Christian and burned them. At this point, he became paranoid, lonely, cruel, and more madness. He built the most lavish palace, a reflection of himself, and bled the money from Rome by asking the rich to pay for his palace with slavery and forced labor. The Domus Aurea, then in 69 AD, he was overthrown. Nero's palace came back in life in 1500 AD from a sinkhole. In 69 AD, as Rome had no more heirs to the throne, the victorious power struggle fight with general was Vespasian. All was for the people. He drained the lake of Nero and built a Colosseum, also known as a Flavian amphitheater. Built with the sale of previous Jewish relics from a Jewish temple in Jerusalem, and then slaves from there were brought back in Rome to build it. It was two Greek theaters back to back and created a theater in Iran. Massive water tunnels were under the theater from the Nero time, and this was used to flood the theater for ship battle. The civilization was reaching the height of its power. By the end of the first AD, Roman Empire extended from England to Egypt and Portugal to Persia. All 15 million people were loyal subjects to one Italian emperor until 98 AD. A non-Roman, an outsider, was Trajan, from Spain, a warrior adopted son of Emperor Nerva. He started to repair the harbors, the road, public buildings, new aqueducts, and new bath on top of the Nero crumbling house. The Roman covered his palace with dirt, built a bath complex on top, bath of Trajan. He died in 117 AD. His adopted son took throne, Hadrian. A military man, he realized that the size of its borders, defenses would be difficult to maintain. He built a 15-foot tall wall to keep his soldier active, to keep Britannia, called Hadrian Wall, with miles, castles, and towers. Hadrian wanted his own building legacy. He rebuilt a burned-out building of Augustus' time, the Pantheon. Until one century later, Rome declined with the Emperor Caracalla, a corrupt power murderer who rose to power, a tyrant who ruled by fear. He built a bath complex to cleanse his past sin, to prove himself as worthy of the imperial power. A success, but not for his reign. His bath project cost money and strained the economy. Then he invaded Persia and Armenia with more cost to the economy. Hoping to be successful in his conquest, he was murdered in 217 AD after 6 years of cruelty and intimidation ruling by his guards. 1 year later, a fire gutted the Colosseum and the soul of the capital. The empire did not recover. Over the next 3 centuries, the empire slowly died. Destructions in an aqueduct, burning Germanic fights among, the empire was too large. The capital crumbled, 99% decreased. And that was the end of the Roman Empire. Romanesque architecture is a style of the medieval Europe demonstrating designs such as semicircular arches. The beginning date of the Romanesque style is suspected to be from the 6th to the late 10th century. During the first Romanesque, the use of thick walls, rubble walls, smaller windows, and vaulted roofs were utilized, but during the second Romanesque, it increased the use of vault and dressed stone, as seen in the Pisa Tower and the Maria-like Abbey in Germany. Romanesque, a term meaning descendant from Roman, is a combination of ancient Roman and Byzantine, and it is known for its massive quality, thick wall, round arches, solid and stable pillars, groin vaults, large towers, and decorative arcade. Buttresses not really needed caused by the wall thickness, and they were often flat square profile. In the churches above the aisles, there was barrel vault and half barrel vaults helping to buttress the nave. Arches were semicircular. Capitals were often Corinthian style. Corinthian capital with anthropomorphized details can be seen with the Pisa Campanile in Italy. The churches were symmetrical design in architecture. They had blind and open arcade, which is a row of arches. They also had piers used to support arches with vertical shaft and drum columns. Most of the survivor buildings were were fortified with walls for protections. All of those without has vanished and destroyed. This was a main style in Europe since the Roman Empire. Massive amount of churches were built during the late 11th and the 12th century. Example of churches were Santa Maria in Cosmedin in Rome, the Baptistery in Florence, and San Zeno Maggiore in Verona, aux Dames et les Hommes at Caen, and many more. We have seen the development of monasteries like in the monasticisms, where religions become members of an order, like monks. Churches were built by the return of the nobility of Europe to thank God after the Crusades' intentions to wrest the holy places. What is Byzantine? Where does it come from? Well, during the Roman Empire, the Byzantine was a continuation to the East in late antiquity and Middle Ages, circa 330-1453 AD. The capital was then Constantinople, Istanbul today. During its life, the Byzantine Empire, Roman Empire, was at its most powerful in economy, cultural, and military. Early Byzantine architecture got elements of Roman architecture. With that in mind, the architectural result was Greek cross-planning churches architecture. Bricks, stone, plaster, classical orders, mosaics, domes on piers, windows with thin sheets of alabasters. So in early Byzantine, Justinian's architects invented a complex system providing for a smooth transition from square plan of the church to a circular dome by means of pendentive. In the Gothic, as seen today as Goth movement, this is a starting in Western Europe from the 12th century to the 16th century, and pointed arches were dominant characteristic of the style. It had various elements associated to the design. Such designs were synchrofoil, cusp, flying buttresses, pointed arches, ribbed vault, towers, spires, pinnacles, large windows, tracery, rows, windows and trefoil, clustered columns, ambulatories, wheel windows, carved door, tympana, and very ornate facades, referred often as the West Front. Inspirations of the pointed arches, which is the main characteristics of the Gothic, was from the Islamic architecture. In the Gothic style, height is predominant and very imposing to the one looking at the inside structure. Vertically is the main effect of the building. It also has a half column called attached shaft, which traveled all the way up to the vaulted ceiling. The glass was often stained glass. This style flourished during the high and late medieval period. As we all know, it started from Romanesque and followed by the Renaissance architecture. The word Gothic appeared in the late Renaissance. Mostly, it is the architecture by far for all ecclesiastical churches, palaces, town halls, guild halls, universities, and dorms. Most of the large churches are listed with UNESCO, which means United Nations Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization. Knowingly, Gothic architecture was a late medieval period. Then we have the Renaissance. During the Renaissance, when looking at various building structure and architecture with this design, the most fascinating civilizations in visual art and in architecture, for my taste, were the Italians in Florence. During the Renaissance, a period in Europe that started in the 14th century to the 17th century, was in a way considered the cultural passage between the Middle Age and the modern history. Soon within around 1490s to the 1520s, the High Renaissance developed in the field of visual art, painting, sculptures, and architecture, as seen within the world of Leonardo da Vinci, Michelangelo, and Raphael. In the same manner would be the reign of architecture, where we see the magnificent work of Filippo Brunelleschi, the Dome of Florence Cathedral, the Basilica di Santa Maria del Fiore, where they comprehended space and mass. There were three key figures in Renaissance architecture, which were Filippo Brunelleschi, Leon Battista Alberti, and Andrea Palladio. Nonetheless, we see a progress in science, philosophy, invention, Greek book of architecture. There was a global movement of qualities of a style, music, and art. It is said that it was a renaissance of a second mentality in relation to architecture, design, science, engineering, and construction. It had proportions, rhythm, and harmony. What is proportion? It is the relation to whole to parts and parts to whole. It was the rebirth of classical culture. It dealt with additive and subtractive in design, as seen in the Duomo with additive and at the Villa Farnese with subtractive. Next subject is mannerisms, which followed the Renaissance. It developed in the late High Renaissance around 1520 until 1580, and finally replaced by Baroque. It is harmony, emphasizing on proportion, balance, and ideal beauty mainly. By encouraging those qualities, it often was seen as asymmetric with its exaggerated qualities. Sophistication was elevated to be almost unnaturally elegant. We can see that in a Parmigianino Madonna with a long neck. It was also marked by elongated proportions, highly stylized poses, and lack of clear perspective. In Laocoon and His Sons is a mannerism sculpture. It depicts the Trojan priest Laocoon and his sons, Antiphanted and Thymbraeus, being attacked by sea serpents. In architecture, the use of forms to emphasize solid and spatial relationships. The best mannerism architect was Michelangelo Buonarroti, 1475 to 1564. Famous for his giant order, a large pilaster that goes from the bottom to the top of the facade, as seen in Campidiglio in Roma, sometimes two or more stories. Later, in the 17th century, Andrea Palladio used it in a movement named Neo-Palladian, as we can see in the facade of Palazzo Chiaricati in Vicenza.